Now, think about it. I have downloaded some program. I don't even know what it does. But I have a very stringent security policy. And when I now run the program through JVM, what will JVM do? JVM interprets and executes it, no? But before interpretation, what will it verify? The instructions in the bytecode, is it violating, negating your security policy? If the program is trying to write the hard, to hard disk, don't execute. If the program is trying to connect to some internet, don't execute. If the program is trying to access some folder that it should not access, don't execute. Are you with me? So who is in now control of security? No, not JVM. The customer. Customer is the one who can configure the security policy, and he is in now control of the security, is it not? Which basically means he can download any Java program, malicious also, which tries to harm his system, but can any Java program harm his system at all? Absolutely not. Such a thing was not possible in C++, because in C++, what is it you get when you download is what code? Machine code. And in machine code, when you ask the machine to run, remember this, machine is very fast, but it's a muttal. Will the machine run any machine code or not? Will you, if at all you have written some program to corrupt the boot record, which basically means your machine cannot boot only, even that program, will it the machine also run? Yes. But in Java, any program that is run is first going to be verified by the JVM, that is the program violating the security policy. Only if it is not, it will run. Otherwise, it will hide the program, thereby giving security to your customer. So, different levels of security. So, JVM, so Java gives us, first of all, in your runtime libraries, what does it give you? It gives you the ability to implement authorization and authentication without writing a lot of code. It gives you all encryption decryption libraries, which means you don't need to implement algorithms. I'm sure you would have seen or heard of RSA algorithm, 64-bit algorithm, 128-bit encryption algorithm, etc. You don't need to implement all this. All this is available in your runtime library. That means you can readily have access to this. You don't need to code for it. And at the same time, what is JVM associated with is a security policy. These are the things which is the meaning when we say Java is said to be secure. Does it make sense or not? Even without learning Java, can you still say, this is not bad, man. This is something nice. Because C and C++ did not allow this. That's why people of C and C++ developers took up and sat up and took notice, and they were very impressed. And that's why they all shifted to the Java bandwagon. Last couple of things. Bear with me. I'm pushing you today. My apologies. Java is said to be dynamic and distributed. I'll just tell you two words about this, because it's very difficult to explain this particular point unless you see some code. By the way, what is considered the most popular advantage of Java is? Popular advantage. Platform independence. However, the most powerful feature of Java is this. Java being dynamic and distributed. In fact, the reason why Java exists today in the forms that we have seen across all the four domains is because Java is dynamic and distributed. I'll tell you what it means briefly. It won't make too much sense. We will wait to understand this better in detail at a later time. Having said that, distributed and dynamic. So Java being dynamic means that a Java program can run another Java program which it does not even know existed. A Java program can execute another Java program, or let's say a Java function which it did not even know existed. That's why we call Java programs as dynamic. Dynamic means at a run time they can discover other programs. We will talk more about this in depth. This is the most important functionality of Java. Don't worry too much about it. But having said that, I will refer to it as saying that a Java program can run another Java program which it did not even know existed when the program was actually coded. That's why we say Java is dynamic. And because Java is dynamic, we can use Java to build distributed applications. What's a distributed application? One application need not have to run in one machine. One application can have code across machines. And what can a Java program do? It can connect to a machine and download the bytecode from another machine. And this is new bytecode. And Java is dynamic, which means this new bytecode, what it can do? It can execute. So a Java program can download bytecode from at runtime and have it be executed. And a Java program can invoke other Java programs running on different machines. Thereby, we can build one application sitting not on one machine, but many machines. This is the cornerstone, the most basic fundamental feature of, not Java, Java 2. Outside if you go, what do you see? Cloud. Mega. Cloud. Your cloud computing. Your cloud computing is all about running a program not in one machine, but many machines. Are you with me? So Java is inherently distributed and dynamic, super important feature. We'll be talking a lot about it in depth. Today we are just trailer. This is the trailer. We don't know the story fully yet. We'll understand it all in detail. What is the last one? Multi-threaded. Very easy to relate to this. What is multi-threaded? You can understand this once you know what is multi-tasking. Tell me, what is multitasking? Ability to execute more than one task. Array. More than one task by who? Who has the ability to execute more than one task? OS? Processor? Okay, forget about computers. Can you tell me, I and you, are we multitasking or not? Okay, that means you have the ability to execute many tasks simultaneously. How? Tell me. Can you drink coffee and drink tea simultaneously? Can you drink coffee and tie your shoelace simultaneously? Can you write in a book and play a piano simultaneously? No, huh? Then how are you multitasking?
We can see and hear simultaneously.
I got that. Obviously, we are multitasking. If we were not multitasking, we could not have achieved anything in life. Correct? No. When I say we are multitasking, our body is multitasking. Specifically, if you see what is multitasking, is our brain. But specifically, if you see our brain, do you know how many parts it contains? Three parts. Medulla oblongata, cerebellum, corticular region. You understand? Medulla oblongata, if you remember from the science we have studied, has taken about 250 million years to evolve. This medulla oblongata part. The medulla oblongata connects to the spinal cord. Through the spinal cord, your interactions will happen with the central nervous system to all the different parts of your body. That medulla oblongata, do you know, we share the same medulla oblongata with a dinosaur. Dinosaur, which was there. They are the same thing, man. Dinosaur, illi and kelbedi. Illi. The cerebellum part, right? The big part of the brain. This has taken 80 million years to evolve. 80 million years. And definitely your dinosaurs did not have that. They had medulla oblongata. They did not have cerebellum. Your monkeys have it. 99.98%. We discussed now. Same. Control C, Control V. Anyway, this part, the corticular part of the brain, has taken evolved over last 20 million years. Monkeys also don't have this. This is the seat of your mind, seat of your thinking and emotions, this part, right? So these are other functions. Now, cerebellum and medulla oblongata, both are multitasking. That means, clearly while you are listening to me, thinking about going home, break padatana illale, yenappa, right? And you're thinking about all this, is your heart pumping blood or not? No, huh? Yeah. Clearly, does your spinal cord come to you or brain come to you and ask you, heart, shall I beat the heart or not? Please tell me. Is something coming and asking you? Is the liver going to come and ask you? Nenne yenana thokambitidya, clean madla bedva. Is the liver going to ask you? Is the kidney going to ask you? What nonsense have you drank and eaten, man? Shall I clean up all your system or not? Remember, all of these things are happening in parallel to what you are doing. Of course, this is silly. Everybody knows. But that is what we call as multitasking. But please note, how many processors there are for multitasking is only one. It is important to understand multitasking in different ways. One from the body. Now comes the mind. We are multitasking in mind too. Like for example, what tasks we do outside the body, not just within the body. Outside the body also we can be multitasking, is it not? You might be listening to a song at the same time writing something. You might be talking something, giving instructions to somebody, and at the same time watching some news and processing that information. So we are multitasking at different levels. Now, before we go, we will go too much into depth into this at a later time. Tell me, what is the benefit of multitasking?
Time saving.
What, multitasking saves time as compared to sequential tasking. If the heart has to beat first and then only kidney has to do its job, then only liver has to do its job, then only stomach has to digest, then only intestine has to do its job, then clearly you would have fallen dead. Correct, no? All of them are doing it parallelly, which is why we are aram. Is it not? So, sequential tasking is slower, multitasking is faster. While I do not agree to this 100%, and we will talk about it later, definitely you are right to some extent that multitasking improves throughput. It gives you, in lesser time, you can execute many tasks. Now, what we want in a program is, one program might contain many tasks. And each task, we want to execute it in parallel. Normally speaking, who is multitasking in any system is your OS. And that is what we call as multi-dash. OS ability to multitask. See, multitasking is a concept. It's a concept. Executing many tasks by one processor is called multitasking. But then OS ability to multitask is called multi-processing. Multi-processing is the implementation of this feature called multitasking. See, it's like this in real world. Your Vishwanathan Anand is a chess grandmaster. If you ask him to play chess, you know, when he comes to universities, they ask him to play chess for, you know, just a demonstration. You know how many players he will play against at one time? 50 people. There will be 50 opponents with all chess games. And how many Vishwanathan Anands? Hey, only one, man. Only one. Immediately he will make a move and he will not wait for the opponent to make a move. He goes to the next opponent, makes a move. And by the time this first person has scratched his head and made the move, Vishwanathan Anand is back, checkmate, gone. Single processor executing many tasks simultaneously. That ability is what will give you speedy throughput. But who knows about this multitasking at your system level is your OS. And OS knows how to execute many programs simultaneously. Like when you open Windows, is your Chrome browser running with your media player, playing some music with your, MuTorrent, downloading some movie from the internet with your Windows word processor where you are editing your resume, all of these programs are running simultaneously or not? Yes. But who knows how to multitask is your OS. But then what have we done with OS? Do we want to talk to the OS from our Java program? The moment we talk to our Java program, from our Java program to our OS, we become OS dependent. Platform dependent. We don't want to be platform dependent. That's why, what is it we want? We want the ability to execute multiple tasks in our Java program in parallel, but without communicating with OS. Java is one of the first language where it introduced multi-threading as a what feature? JVM feature. Multitasking now is a JVM feature, not the OS feature. That means, if you learn this multitasking JVM feature, any Java program you can write without communicating to the OS and have it be multitasking enabled. This is the big deal. And this is a very important point. We'll be spending a significant amount of time in learning this. And the beauty is, all I want you to understand is this. In C, C++, you wanted to multitask, have to learn about OS. In Java, you want to multitask, you just need to learn about That's it. That means we are completely independent again of the OS and platform. So that's why all of these features are Java language features. Now, in comparison, even without knowing too much of C and C++, can you say all these are big benefits or not? Clearly, yes. Build a program only once. Have it be runnable everywhere forever. Even 20 years down the line, our Java program will run across newer platforms. Clearly, you want to learn Java and build complex programs, you don't need to learn complex features at all. It is all taken care of by JVM for you, and you don't need to learn anything about the OS and hardware, which means simpler to learn. And any program that you write, because there are no complexity, there are lesser number of bugs. More reliable, more robust. And your program, once it is built, it supports many languages. Date, calendar number formatting, without ever having to write code. Internationalized. And your code, your application will encrypt your data, we will automatically get authorization and authentication. Most importantly, customer can create a security policy protecting himself from vagaries. At the same time, your Java program need not have to run in one machine. It can download bytecode from other machines and make it a part of its own dynamically and executed. Or it can invoke programs running on another machines. Distributed application development can happen. At the same time, clearly your Java programs can, within one program, we can execute many tasks in parallel, but without having to communicate with OS, just by learning the feature of? Can you relate to all these features at a high level? Yes or no? Better say yes, otherwise I'll go on for next 3 hours. No, just kidding. So obviously you are able to relate to it. And clearly all C, C++ developers, they should sat up and took note of Yappa Yen Super. All these things you get, which was not available in C, C++, that's why, directly. That's why all those guys came into the Java bandwagon, and the rest, so to say, is history. And we are talking about what features were there in Java in 1995-96, and now it is 2016. In these 20 years, this is Java JDK 1, and right now there is JDK 8. There are 1,000 more features that have been added. Are you with me? That's why Java is considered a robust ecosystem, the platform to develop applications in, the most popular job platform, and the maximum number of companies working on it. Are you with me? This kind of ties in the basic benefits of what makes Java advantageous. But what is the point we have not talked about, which is very important for us before we get into actual programming, is object-oriented programming. You will love the discussion. It is very entertaining, interesting, and also there are many wonderful insights. All of this we will discuss tomorrow in the next session in depth, and from day after tomorrow we will actually start with Java. We have not yet started with Java. We have just understood at a high level some terminologies and some benefits. We still don't get to know the benefits. When can we get to know the benefits is only when you start coding, and start in a couple of days time. Are you all with me? Excellent.